Well, you bunch of deadheads. If you're glad you're saved, say amen. Amen. Don't let the cane fool you. I just use it to get sympathy. Doctor says I need a new hip. I said, well, I used to be a hippie. But he won't give me a new hip till I lose weight. I said, okay, so in the meantime, this thing is really hurting, Doc. Give me some meds. He laughed. He said, Randy, I go to your church. He said, you're not getting anything. Go get some generic Tylenol. You'll be fine. He won't give me anything. No Lortab, no Darvocet, no Percodan, no Percocet, no Oxycontin. Yeah, I know all the names. I just can't have any. Praise God. Amen. So I'm going to lose weight and get a new hip. In fact, I'm going to get a brand new body when Jesus comes. Amen. Right now, my wife Cindy calls me her chunk. On that day, I'm going to be her hunk. Praise God. Good to see you. You all look a lot better than I do, I guarantee you. Aren't you glad you're saved? Thank you, Brother Matt, for inviting me in. I didn't know if I'd ever get to preach here again after you became pastor. I didn't know if you liked me or not. But I still don't, but at least you let me preach. Amen. So thank you, Pastor Matt. It's got a good ring to it, doesn't it? I think he's doing a great job, don't you? Man, I love this guy. And thank God for all that he's doing here at the church. I was a little nervous, to be honest, to hear that there's not going to be a Dixon in the pulpit. You know, what are you going to do? Well, I'll tell you what you're going to do. You're still going to be the church. And Jesus is still Lord, and he's still the shepherd. And praise God for people getting saved, getting baptized. Nothing can stop the church of God. Amen? So thank the Lord. It's so encouraging to know that the work goes on for the glory of God. Amen? Now, I know some of you are probably getting hungry, so I won't take long. Of course, long is a relative term. But if you turn to the book of Revelation, chapter 19, maybe that will get you excited. Revelation 19 and verse 11. While you're turning there, greetings from Alabama in Coleman, halfway between Huntsville and Birmingham on Interstate 65. We live about a block and a half off Interstate 65, Alabama exit number 310. Come by any time. My wife will cook you a home-cooked dinner and wash your clothes and shine your shoes. Spend the night. Bring your whole family. Spend a few days or weeks. I don't care. I won't be there, so just come on by. My wife will love it. I have so much fun when she's not with me. But greetings from my beautiful redhead Cindy and my just knockout, beautiful, brunette, 17-year-old daughter, Abby. And she is, man, God's working in her heart. She's maturing and making the honor roll. And went out, and a couple weeks ago, I didn't even know she was doing it. Cindy and I didn't tell her she had to get a job. You know, we'll pay her bills. Only 17, still in school. But she knew we didn't have a lot of extra money to give her any spending money and stuff. And she went out and found out who was hiring and made application, went three times for interviews, and finally, just a couple weeks ago, got hired at Office Max, working at a cashier. And I went in for the first time yesterday morning before I left town. And I snuck in the back where she wouldn't see me. And she was standing there just doing all that thing on the computer and adding people's stuff up and smiling and being so nice and giving the change back. And, oh, man, I thought, man, if they only knew. But I'm so proud of her. I hope you can tell. she went on like a semi pseudo almost kind of halfway date, first date that I'm aware of. And this dude named Clint was going to take her to Huntsville to go shopping, about 30 minutes away. And she said, "I'm going shopping with Clint." I said, "Clint who?" She said, "That's all you need for now." Because she knew I'd look him up and I'd find out about him. I said, "Will you bring him by so I can..." She said, "No, Dad, I'm not bringing him by. You're going to tell him to keep his zipper up, keep his pants on, tell him you're going to kill him." "No, I'm not bringing him by." So I don't know, you know, about Clint. But she came home all right, on time, looked good, okay. But I'm going to find out who he is. And I will kill him. And then, of course, my incredibly handsome son, Will. Most of you have met Will. He's in college now in New York City at the only Christian college in New York called the King's College. And he's doing great there on the dean's list. And he's running for helmsman, whatever that means. It's an office in, you know, the school. And he's going to be helming. Don't ask me. But it's supposed to be pretty cool. So, and he's doing great. He loves it. And last week, I got to go preach in the Washington, D.C. area. I preached seven times in 5 days at several different venues, and in 5 days, to the glory of God, 134 people got saved. 63 were called to preach, accepted the call to full-time service. So to God be the glory. Amen? How many believe the Bible is the word of God? Say amen. This isn't my word or your word. This is God's word, isn't it? If you're under the age of 21, raise your hand. Raise your hand high. Raise them up, young people. Under the age of 21, from the age of 4 to 21, raise them up high. Man, you're scattered all over. Adults, give the young people a big hand clap. Man, you're everywhere. Before I forget, I want to tell you that Wednesday night I'm preaching at the sports thing. At what time? 7. Will that be in the gym? Okay, they can invite anybody they want, right? Young people, I want you to invite everybody you know. Saved, unsaved, not sure, atheists, everybody. Wednesday night at 7, right? Over in the gym. Wednesday night at 7. Basketball, volleyball, hanging out, and, are you listening? Absolutely free. Won't cost you or your friends or your family a penny. All the pizza you can eat. How many like pizza? Yeah. How many like free pizza? Yeah. That's what I'm saying, my man. My man. Look like you've had a couple pieces. I've had a couple pies all by myself. We call them pies up in New York. Wednesday night, I'll tell you this, okay, young people, Wednesday night at 7, gym, bring a friend, bring everybody you can, free pizza, all you can eat, all you can drink, free drinks, nothing stronger than Dr. Pepper, okay, all you can drink, I promise you this, you bring your friends or family, bring them Wednesday night at 7 over to the gym, I'm going to preach, it won't be long, because I know you got to play ball and stuff, but I promise you this, if you bring them, and they're not saved, they'll probably get saved. Amen. There's not going to be ever a better chance. You know, invite people. You don't have to dress up. You're not going to church. You're going to do some balling. You know, you're not going to do some balling. You know, like the Pacers used to do. They used to ball. This city's falling apart since I left. Do you understand? It's in bad shape. I need to come back. I'm going to buy the Pacers. One more thing. Tonight, we're having a service at 6:30? 6. It'll be 6 o'clock. Now listen, emergency announcement. Tonight at 6, huge, I don't know if you've heard or not. I do not know if you've heard. But a huge, huge storm warning for tonight at 6. Huge. It's coming right down Southport Road. And at 6 o'clock, it's going to hit. Huge hurricane. Hurricane Hogue tonight at 6 o'clock. Amen. Hurricane Hogue. Don't miss it. 6 o'clock. Going to have some music. Music. And I want to preach again. Won't be long. But don't miss it. Bring everybody you know that needs to get saved. And let's pray a bunch of people get saved tonight. Amen. Some of you have forgot how to listen to me preach. The louder and more often you say amen, the shorter I preach. There's always one or two in a crowd, isn't it? So don't forget tonight at 6, Wednesday night at 7, and then I'm going to be preaching in schools throughout, and then over in Brownsburg next Sunday. But let's ask God to make this a great week of harvest. Amen? To God be the glory. How many of you know somebody that needs to get saved? Raise your hand. Family member, loved one, friend, work, school. Ask God to use you to get them here tonight. What time we start tonight? What? Don't miss it. 6 o'clock. Come as you are. Wear what you want. Kind of casual. Then afterward, you can buy me dinner. Now, I know some of you aren't used to coming on a Sunday night. None of you are used to coming on a Sunday night since the church went liberal and quit having Sunday night service. Just kidding. But some of you are used to staying home Sunday night, you know, kicking back with some chips and dip and watching TV, watching the Ed Sullivan show Sunday night. I know you're used to that. See, I got you right there, young people. You see what I did? You think you know everything. You think you're so smart. You got all these gigabytes. Well, you may have gigabytes, but I know who Ed Sullivan is, and you don't. He's one of the best gigabytes ever. I got your gigabyte. I don't know what I'm talking about. Okay. How many believe the Bible is the word of God? Say amen. Amen. Listen, this is good. This is great. Revelation 19, verse 11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were a flame of fire. On his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And all God's people said, amen. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Everybody say that out loud together. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Say it again. You hear that, devil? Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. Praise God. From what I've read, it was one of the greatest opening weekends of any movie ever. Batman versus Superman. Oh my. The whole world wanted to know who's going to win. These two great superheroes, they're going to fight it out to the death. Batman and Superman. Whoa! And doesn't it say somewhere in there in the Bible, and in heaven he laughed? Oh, man, big old mighty Superman against the wily Batman. Not just Batman. The Batman. You know, that's pretty cool if you're called the Batman. But you know what's cooler? If you're called King of Kings and Lord of Lords. and you take the combined power of Batman and Superman, bring in Iron Man and all the other superheroes, put them all in one person, and they are nothing compared to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That first weekend was a sellout in most theaters. Do you know that the King of Kings and Lord of Lords created every single person? Made them. For us, humans, it started in the book of Genesis. But for Jesus, Father God, Holy Spirit, it started a long time before that. The Bible says in Habakkuk that God came from Mount Teman. Where did God come from? Where did Jesus, the Holy Spirit, where did God, the Trinity, come from? God answered the question. Habakkuk chapter 2, God came from Mount Teman. Look it up. Mount Teman means nothing and nowhere. God came from nowhere because there wasn't anywhere to come from. There wasn't anything to stand on. So he stood on it, and he created everything that therein is. But one day in eternity past, God the Father, his omniscience, his all-knowing from everlasting to everlasting, knew that he would create us. He knew he would give us a free will because he wanted us to love him by choice. And so he created us. And by our own volition, our own free will, we decided to rebel. He said, don't eat that fruit of that tree in that garden. And so Eve did, and Adam did, and thus we did. For one, by one man, Adam, all became sinners, Romans 5:12. We all sin, as that candidate for baptism said today, not just one or two, not a lot of us, we've all sinned, amen? And there's enough preaching in that baptism to save the world, amen? From the young lady and the young man, how glorious that was. And God in heaven, the Bible says in Genesis 6, that it repented God that he made man. Scholars say that's an anthropomorphism. It's a term to relate to people, humans, how God felt. And in the original, it says that it means someone gasping for breath. The best definition I've ever heard is when you're driving down the road and you see a horrible accident happen right in front of you. You screech to a halt. You drive by and you see bodies laying out, thrown out of the car, bleeding. You come upon a horrible accident like that, and what do? You gasp for breath. Oh, it takes your breath away. It's so horrible. They say that's the term used there. When we sinned, and by Genesis 6, in the day of Noah, we had sinned so horribly that sin was covering the entire world. That every man, woman, boy, and girl were in sin, all headed to hell, needing a Savior, needing a Redeemer, needing someone to forgive their sin, to take away their sin, to die for their sin, to pay for their sin. And God the Father knew a Savior would have to come here. And he perused all his created glory of heaven, those celestial beings, those archangels, those like Gabriel, who were so beautiful in their heavenly splendor. Maybe Gabriel can go. He looked at Michael. Oh, beautiful Michael, the archangel. Maybe he can go. But the Father instantly knew they did not qualify. They could not meet the stated conditions. Can you imagine that moment, that nanosecond, their eyes met, the Father and the Son, when God looked at Jesus and Jesus looked at his Father God. Do you think Jesus may have said something like, Father, it's me, isn't it? I'm the only one that can go. Yes, son, you must go. I'm the only root of David. I'm the only one that meets the conditions, right, Father? That's right, son. And I'm going to go down there because we love them, right? Yes, son, because we love them. We don't want them to continue to live in their sin, to die in their sin, and to go to hell. I'm going to have to die, aren't I, Father? Yes, son. And you will be persecuted. You will be beat to within an inch of your life. You will be tortured as no man has ever been tortured. Jesus, will you go? Yes, Father. Can you imagine when that moment came? When the father had to say goodbye to his son and the son had to say goodbye to his father? They had not been separated for a second. Forever. Remember the time you said goodbye to your little kindergartner or your first grader? And you took that little girl to the bus stop? Maybe you remember yourself that day when you went away from home for the first time to go to first grade and hugging your mommy. Mommy, I don't want to go. Honey, you have to go. You'll be back this afternoon. I'll be here waiting on you. Mommy! Goodbye, honey. I'll see you this afternoon. Remember when you went off to the service? Remember, sir, when you went off to the army? Remember your mom crying and hugging on you? I love you, son. I love you, mom. And your dad standing there pretending to be strong. You represent us, boy. Yes, sir. And you reach out to shake his hand. He can't take it any longer. He breaks down and just gives you a big old bear hug. I love you, boy. You be careful. Call us when you get there. Yes, sir. Remember when you left town for the first time on that job transfer? Remember the relocation? Remember those fond farewells? Remember going off to college? I remember I went off to college and standing at the front of the driveway to get in Brother Greg's car, drive to Springfield, Missouri, going off to college. I can't really remember how long it took him to say goodbye, but I do remember thinking, just come on, let's go. But sometimes it's hard to say goodbye, isn't it? Can you remember? A lot of emotions, a lot of hugs and tears. But can you imagine the day when Jesus said goodbye to his father? Not for a day or an afternoon, not for a semester or a year, for 3 years. Is it any wonder that more than anything, when he was on earth, Jesus looked forward to those early morning times up on the mountain when he would meet with his father? How precious they must have been. No wonder he came down from the mountain shining with the glory of God on him. Can you imagine when they hugged in heaven? I love you, Dad. I love you, son. I'll be there every morning, okay? Yes, Dad, on the mountaintop. I won't miss it. See you then, son. Remember that morning? No room in the inn. He was born in a barn of a virgin mother named Mary, a surrogate father named Joseph. The most unique birth of all time. Born as old as his father and older than his mother. that baby boy. God became flesh. Lord himself to become a little baby, to grow up 5, 6, 7, 8 years old playing with his little buddies. Can you imagine the temptations he must have had to show off his superpowers? But the Father said, no, wait. There's an appointed time for that. And that appointed time came, didn't it? Remember in John chapter 2 when they were at the wedding in Cana? They ran out of wine. And so Jesus' mother said, they have no wine. Make some wine. Come on, you're God. Show them who you are, Jesus. No, Mom. I'm not going to do that right now. Your time's coming. I know you're tired of being made fun of and mocked and not believed and called a liar. They don't believe anybody can be a virgin and have a baby like you did. And I may take care of this business with the water and the wine, but my time's not yet come. I'm not going to prove to them I'm God just yet. Wait 2 or 3 more years, Mom. Hang in there. He turns the water into wine. But his time hadn't come. But one day, his time did come. After choosing his disciples, after being baptized by John the Baptist, after beginning his ministry of loving the unlovely, befriending the lonely, giving to the poor, healing the lame, giving sight to the blind, forgiving the sinners, giving new life to the dead. Finally, for all of his benevolent activities, all he ever did was love and love and love and love. He never hurt anybody. He never lied to anyone. He never stole anything. He never sinned. He never did. He was the only one that lived a perfect life on this planet. And for all of what he did and who he was, they took him out. And the Bible says in the book of Acts, he was taken out and crucified. Remember that day? When they came to Pilate, and the Pilate told the crowd, hungry for blood. They love coming to these things. They love to see the blood, the gore, the killing, the crucifying. And Pilate said, I have 2 men. The one you tell me to release will go free. The one you tell me to release will not be killed. You tell me, crowd. I have one here named Jesus. I'm not aware of anything he did wrong. He committed no crime that I'm aware of. And I have another man here named Barabbas. He's a thug. He's a criminal lifer. All he does is wrong. Some of his thug friends are here to watch him get killed because that's what he deserves. So, crowd, said Pilate, which one will you have? I'll give you either one and he can go free. Do you want Jesus to go free or do you want Barabbas to go free? And the crowd yelled, give us Barabbas. Barabbas! 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 Why does God take the time to tell us about that in his holy word? Because he wants us to understand who we are. We're not Jesus. We're not Pilate. We're Barabbas. He deserves to be killed. He deserves the punishment. And notice, there's nothing in Scripture about Barabbas going back to Jesus and saying, oh, thank you, Jesus. Because he doesn't think Jesus released him. He thinks the crowd released him. He thinks his thug friends from the hood paid off the crowd and said, yell for Barabbas. We're getting our buddy out of this. Pilate didn't release him. The crowds didn't release him. God was in charge of this affair. You know what released him? The love. the unmitigated, unconditional, everlasting love of a heavenly Father and a loving Son. He didn't get that. And if you waste your day getting up this morning, getting ready, driving over here to church, waiting through all the songs and all the prayers and all the preaching, and you leave here and you don't get that, it'll be an entire waste. You're not Jesus. I'm not Jesus. We're not Pilate. We're Barabbas. We all need a Savior. Barabbas wasn't set free by the crowd. He was set free by Jesus. Barabbas doesn't go back and say, thank you, Jesus. He thinks his crony friends in the crowd did it. He thinks he just did it by his own power. Don't leave today and go back into the crowd without thanking Jesus for setting you free. I don't know what all Barabbas had done, but I got a pretty good idea that none of you in this room has done anything worse than Barabbas. He was probably a murderer. We know he was a thief. We know he was a criminal. We know he was the worst of society. So what have you done? Young person, look at me. What have you done that makes you think you're outside of the love of God? God loves you, and if you'll let him, he'll save you today. Please get saved. Please, sir, get saved. You want the best for your family? Mom, you love your kids. The greatest thing you can do today for your family is get saved. The greatest thing you can do today for your soul is get saved. Please get saved. Come to Christ. Don't go back out to the crowd ungrateful. Walk out of here a missionary, saved, forgiven, on your way to heaven to go tell others and bring them in tonight at 6. Amen? And they took Jesus and they tied him to a tree and they whipped his back over and over and over again until his back was nothing but blood, skin and bones ripped to shreds. They took about an 800-pound tree, tied it with another big tree, making a cross. They threw it on his back. And then they said, march. March, Jesus, up the Via Dolorosa, the way of the cross, 600 yards uphill with the cross. After being tortured to within an inch of his life, it's no wonder that he stumbled as he walked up Calvary's road. It's no wonder that he cried out as the blood from his side flowed. It's no wonder heaven blackened when all sin crushed the divine. And it's no wonder my life was transformed when I saw that sin as mine. Thank God he walked up Calvary's road. Helped along by Simon of Cyrene, they finally got to the top of the hill called Golgotha. That means the place of the skull. I've been up there. There's nothing but death up there. Skulls and bones. Death and devastation. They laid the cross on the ground. They threw Jesus down on the cross. They tied his wrists so he wouldn't move. They took a spike and they nailed it into his wrist, through the skin of his wrist. They nailed it through the bone, through the skin, through the blood vessels, through the flesh, through it all, out the other end, into the tree, into the wood. They took his other hand and released it from that hand and they put it on the other end of the other cross. They nailed it to the wood, all the way through the wrist. You're too tough for Jesus. You're too cool to get saved. You're too hard for his love. Then go home and take a big old 16-penny nail and a hammer and nail that nail through the wrist. Have a friend, have a buddy do it. See how it hurts. Of course you wouldn't do that. Don't do that. That'd be stupid. That'd be foolish. That'd be the worst pain you can imagine. They did it to both wrists. And do you know why he let them? Because he loves you. Please don't leave without Jesus. Make fun of me. Criticize me. I don't care. But don't criticize Jesus. Don't make fun of Jesus. Please don't ignore the Christ. He went through all this for you. They took his ankles and they tied them together. And they took another huge spike. And they took that spike and they drove it through the first ankle all the way through into the second ankle all the way through into the wood. They raised that cross up with his body, now over 1,000 pounds of weight. They threw it in the pre-prepared hole. And when it hit the bottom of the hole with a thud, all that weight, the Bible says in Psalm 22, my bones stare upon me. You know what that means? That means his bones went out of joint. Ever had a broken bone? You ever break your arm, break your ankle? Do you know that although that's horribly painful, a bone that goes out of joint is many times more painful. But it wasn't just one for him. The only assumption we have from Scripture is that all of his bones were out of joint with that thud. It literally broke the body of Jesus. Can you imagine the pain? And so they offer him some gall. They give him what my doctor won't give me. You know what gall is? They took a big stick and wrapped a cloth around it and dipped it. You know what gall is? It's raw opium juice. It's the purest form of morphine. It laughs at Oxycontin, which is the poor man's morphine, hillbilly heroin. They took pure morphine juice. Here, Jesus. They pushed it up to his mouth. Come on, Jesus. Lick it. Let it relieve your pain. Thank God he pushed it away. He said no. You know why he said no? He said no to drugs on the cross. So I could say no to drugs in this life. I don't have to be controlled by them anymore. I don't have to be enslaved to them anymore. Some of you don't know my testimony, but I was just a street drug addict. I was nothing but a plain drug addict. That's all I was. And thank God one day I found myself in this church. I heard the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I got saved. The Shannons let me come live with them. They wouldn't let me have anything. They let me have some food if I memorized scripture. That's about it. Was it hard? Yes, it was hard. Is it hard on this hip just to take Tylenol? Of course it is. But thank God, he gives me power to overcome that temptation. And it may not be a big deal, probably a big deal to any of you at all. But to a drug addict, are you kidding me? I know I could. I don't have enough doctor's script. It's what the internet's for. FedEx, overnight, all the oxy you want. But I don't need that. My body says I need it. But praise God, I'm free. I'm free. I'm not perfect. I overeat. I got to lose weight. I got to get a new hip. Got a lot of issues that say I'm not perfect. But I'll tell you one thing. I'm drug free today to the glory of God. By God's power, by his help, and by his healing, only God can help you overcome temptation. For some of you, it's sex. It's pornography. It's other women. I have to deal with that. I'm in a hotel. The women, the real babes, they see this. I'm attacked all the time. They're all over me. Try to stop the elevator. I've heard stories of the preachers even. I don't have one story of a woman trying to climb my body. Not one. Just let me have one so I can tell it. It's my moneymaker right here. That's why I'm poor. Doesn't make me a penny. Aren't you glad you're free? Aren't you glad you don't have to sin? Do we? Yeah. Yeah, we slip up, but we don't have to. Amen. We've got a power beyond our power. We've got a strength beyond our strength. We have Jesus. Because he said no to sin on the cross. We can say no to sin in this life. Amen. He died. They buried him. And they thought, there, that's that. It's over. He's gone. And for 3 days, he stayed in that tomb. But he wasn't just laying there dead. He was taking care of business. I said, he's taking care of business. He looked old man devil, old man sin, old man death, old man hell right in the eyes, and they went for him. They went for his jugular. They tried to take him down. They tried to kill him. They tried to defeat him. They tried pouring all of mankind's sin on him, but he kicked them in the face, and on the third day, he rose himself up from the dead. He arose, a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose, a victor on the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. Hallelujah! He arose and he lives forever. Take that, devil. Amen. Tell me I can't jump. Glory to God. Anybody have any Tylenol? I'll pay for that all week. But it's worth it. Amen. Glory to God. Wait till I get my new hip. Look out, devil, amen. He really did raise from the dead. He really was seen by over 500 people for a month, walking around, alive. He really is God. He's God. He's God. And he rose up off Mount Olivet one day to see his father. What a reunion that must have been, huh? What hugs in heaven on that day when they were reunited. But he didn't leave us alone. He left us with the power of the Holy Spirit. And he told us to use that power to go out and be a witness, to tell others what we know. That Jesus saves, that Jesus heals, that Jesus delivers, that Jesus forgives. And now here we are 2,000 years later. Let us be found faithful, obeying him, carrying out the mission. Let's not get comfortable, folks. No, the church didn't fall apart when there's a transition of pastors. Now we're doing good. Had a great crowd last Sunday. Great crowd this Sunday. But folks, don't get comfortable. Don't go back to the same old. Keep pressing forward. Keep giving. Keep tithing. Keep being generous. Keep giving. Keep witnessing. Keep serving. Keep loving. Keep showing that indomitable Baptist temple spirit. And it doesn't matter if the devil and all the armies of hell come against you, you're not going to bend. With God's help, you're going to stand. And you're going to stand strong with the power of God. And you're going to overcome temptation. You'll be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. And you're going to be a witness for Jesus. What if you got on the phone today when you get home? And this afternoon, just call everybody that you know that needs the Lord. And say, I'll meet you at the church at 6 o'clock. Huh? You say, Randy, most of them probably won't even come. Well, what if one comes? What if that dad comes and gets saved, goes home, tells the family, whole family gets saved. They come next Sunday, they get baptized, whole family joins the church. Would it be worth it? You bet it would. There are enough people in this room right now who know enough people. We could see 100 people get saved tonight. No problem. But they got to be here. How many are you going to pray for tonight? Raise your hand and say amen. Pray for tonight. I don't care if you have to work. Find somebody to work for you. Quit your job. No, don't quit your job. Family needs your time. But don't quit your job. But you be here. The only other excuse you have is you're pregnant with child, and tonight you go into labor. Don't come over here. You go into that hospital and have that baby. Then win him to Christ. We'll baptize him, and amen, he'll go to heaven. Amen. But I'm not done, because Jesus isn't done. One day, very, very soon, in my opinion, the Bible's very clear. Jesus is coming back again. I don't just say Jesus is coming back again. According to the Bible and the events of this world unfolding, Jesus is not just coming back again. He's coming again soon. It could be any second, any minute, any hour, any day. And you know what's going to happen when he comes back? We're going to see him face to face. We're going to meet him in the air, 1 Thessalonians 4:16. We're going to meet him in the clouds, and we're going to go with Jesus if we're saved. For 7 years, all hell's going to break out on this earth. And then we're coming back with Jesus. And according to the Bible, we're going to reign with him as kings and priests on this earth. Move over, Donald Trump. It's our turn now. Amen. Are you kidding me? I got to pick between Trump and Hillary. Are you serious? I'm moving to Costa Rica. Come on, people. 350 million people in this country, and this is all we got? His hair's a joke. I know, I'm just jealous. Pray for our country, man. You know who gives me hope? No, not Ted Cruz, Jesus. Jesus. As I told you, I was up in D.C. last week, and on Sunday morning, 17-year-old boy got saved. Several were saved, but this 17-year-old boy not only got saved, but he told me to pray for his parents that day, and he waited so he could talk to me personally. I mean, God really got a hold of him. He's broken before God because he knew both of his parents were going to hell. He said, Brother Randy, could you just pray that my parents would come with me? They never come with me. They don't go to church. Pray that they'll come tonight and get saved. Well, they did come with him. I said, you tell them that they don't have to buy you anything for Christmas if they just come. He said, what? I said, just do what I'm saying. Just say, Mom, Dad, you don't have to buy me anything for Christmas. Just come with me for tonight. That'll touch your parents' heart. Just do what I'm saying. He said, man, I don't know. I said, listen to me. If they get saved, you'll have the best Christmas you've ever had. Amen? I said, it works. Trust me. Well, you know what? They came. And Mom and Dad both got saved. And I mean, it was glorious. Pastor knew who they were. He'd been praying for them, the whole family. And so a little kid got saved Sunday morning. Parents came. And as I went out the back, I never forget, both the mom and the dad, the kid was talking to some other friends, but the mom and dad were sitting on the very back pew. And it wasn't part of the church. It was just kind of, you know, a place for people to sit on the back wall. And they're just sitting there. And as I was going out, the mom said, Randy, can I say something? I said, sure. I said, I'm so glad both of you got saved tonight. She was just crying. She said, Randy, our family will never be the same. I said, you're right. It's all brand new. Some of you may be having family problems. If you aren't, and you're perfect, and your family's perfect, then you're just weird. But the rest of us that have problems, you know what's really good? Jesus. Amen. Salvation, a new life. Before I close, can I just say this to you? What these baptismal candidates were saying, and they both said it in different ways. Brother Matt was asking, what'd you do, and so forth. But what they meant was that they gave their life to Christ. They knew they were sinners. They knew the only way to be saved is Jesus. And you don't have to jump through a bunch of hoops. You don't have to sign up and register and write a check every week. You don't have to quit this and quit that. When you get saved, God will help you quit this and quit that. Amen. It starts from the inside out. Some of you, it may be overnight. With me, God just changed me. But have I struggled since? Of course. That's why it's got to be from inside out. And God has helped me along the way to get a victory here and a victory there. But it's all completely free. All of it is. You don't have to pay anything to be saved. Just come to Christ, believe, and be saved. You want your kids to be the happiest kids in the world today, parents? Get saved. Want your parents to be the happiest parents in the world, kids? Get saved. But don't just do it for your family. Don't just do it for your friends. Do it for Jesus, the true superhero. By the way, it doesn't say it specifically, but I'm pretty much 100% sure. If you took Superman and Batman together and made one superhero, Jesus could still beat them. Just boom, gone. Amen. Get on the winning team with heads bowed and eyes closed. Heads are bowed and eyes closed.